is an economist. He dabbles in the best schools. He went to Cambridge. He's now.
Tetapi Radri pemimpin yang memperlihatkan sifat-sifat terbuka. Sudi menerima idea baru. Bagi saya inilah antara sifat-sifat yang membentukkan seorang pemimpin yang boleh mandu sebuah negeri menjadi sebuah negara maju. Sebenarnya jemputan saya ini disasarkan untuk low income. Now lihat apa middle income? Low middle income. So they might reclassify, I hope they don't. But having said that, I think we have a good opportunity to become one. And I want to use examples that I chose Perak and Malaysia because that's where our target group lies. Then I chose a country in all expectations and all measures was more underdeveloped than Malaysia, which is Korea, South Korea. Destination target means you don't really use statistics in a general way. If at all you can use statistics, and you must always be careful that statistics can never be perfect. It's just like the aggregation that Michelle talked about, Her Excellency. I will come back to that point. This is simply to let you know that it doesn't matter that Perak is lagging now. We are behind Penang, behind Johor, but more so behind Selangor. We are even considered inhibitive. Will be a barrier because the notion of Confucianism equated with fatalism. That means Central Jawa. It can even be Irian Jaya, which is part of Indonesia as well, or Sulawesi, or even Kalimantan. And in the case of Malaysia, ethnically divided. For example, Nigeria, high exchange rate will squeeze out manufacturing because manufactured exports will become expensive. Now, while that is happening, commodity prices are known to follow some sort of fluctuations after a while. There is this argument the classical economists come with. And to me, they never question their model. I hope Professor Jamal is here. They never question their model. They come up with potential growth. And if actual growth exceeds two, it's okay for entrepreneurs to make money the way they want. State should invest or build infrastructure and so on, things that can actually synergize an economy. GDP grows up that much. Countries menjadi masyarakat maju in that sense, integrated, but it really happened. We have to question ourselves. Our NEP actually addressed that. And in some ways, we achieved it on paper because we don't really have now a concentration. Unemployment of 15%, underemployment, because the ILO defines unemployment as one where a person during the period in enumeration works for 1 hour a week is considered employed. Current account deficits before the Asian financial crisis struck. For very many years, we had severe deficits. Most of the time, we blame the quasi pact that we had, compared to what used to be there, because high interest rates that look to the ordinary entrepreneur, because to the rest, interest rates were high, only those preferred. This is sometimes you can have political captures. In this case, the landlords captured Marcos, because they are the big guy financing the elections. So even though he wanted to have land reforms, he wasn't. Among the reasons why we became a upper middle income country, when Philippines languished below, we had such kind of public good development under our leaders. We all know about semiconductors, Litar Kamila. Yeah? Now, we know from Moore's law that every 24 months, the minimum line width halves, that's the Moore's law. But the capacity, the circuit doubles, right? In memories, Huang released it to 12 months. So we call that Huang's law now. Now how did Samsung get there? Get there, the same procedure I'm telling you. Two important things, either you acquire, in this case you joint venture with Philips, you can have public research institutes, science parks that can create those sorts of products. And you can have incubators there, small guys coming in, including startups. This guy again from Malaysia, if you compute all the trade index indices, Reveal Comparative Advantage, Global Loyalty Index and so on. We are competitive in a number of products, but they tend to be low value added. In order to be high income, you have to transform from low to high value added activities. That requires commercialization of science. That requires...
Adya, any takers? Anyone? Going once? Okay. Front? Two? Okay. Let's give people behind, because they eat a lot of big prawns at lunch.
from, I was seated next to you this morning. Yeah, my name is Reza from Northern Corridor Communication Authority. Yeah, I noted with interest about the Korean model, how they pursue.
Just like say Timor Leste, which has got 1.5 million people, or maybe the Middle East countries that comparing with other countries for a UNDP project. It's a question of how, in the end, it's human capital. I think our. He was smiling and talking. He's okay when you speak to him in person.
Anymore? It's not always you get the son of the Lord in time to speak about these matters. Yes, one from here. And we... Here we go, it's two first.
Yeah, I'm supposed to be sleeping now, having flown from Boston. But coming back to the first question on distribution. If you look at Korea and Taiwan, efforts by government to develop, simply because it's science-based. New stocks of knowledge are there and adding value. We could do that, but we need to look at the whole cluster chain too. In other words, not just the actual farming. We need to do the R&D too, which is commercializable. That's why we need the science park. And then how? If it requires some amount
of... Gen 1. I'm from the Gen 1 person. Okay, I'm talking about, when you're talking about contribution, what are the contributions that Gen 1 can create because of... We are different in terms of culture. And we can see right now, a lot of people attending for the course here, mostly not really
Gen. Maybe somehow, and Tantri Jafrija talked about the need to be colorblind, to be religion blind. I think if you go back, I did Islamic philosophy, you go back to the first chapter itself, Tantri and Sijaga, oneness and universal. That God created everything, they all belong to Him. Treat them the same, the borrowers and what you get. Now coming back to that, the most important part of FDI is actually technology, embodied knowledge. Now we need to make sure that we appropriate that. In the case of Perak too, we had KASEM, we had a UNISEM and other folks like that. What did we do with the human capital that a lot of them went to Singapore? Because
come here to the back where the question should be. Anyone? Any question from you? Please. Satu soalan je. Tak nak? Tak apalah.
China, because they consider China an extractive state. But sometimes ideas can also work backwards. Even our honorable former Prime Minister Lee Kuan Yew, he actually didn't like the universities for a while. He went to the universities and said, keep all your ideas, but we don't need them. I'm not making the same point. No, I believe these ideas are important. Number two exporter of salmon, which although recently they had problems with salmonella, that's just to make a point, and they adapted it.
Okay. I know you're tired from Boston. I'm stopping. There'll be another session there in the room behind. So please come back, and thank you so much for the opportunity to be here.
Okay. Thank you so much. about lack of resources. It's about low capacity and capability, and it's about low level of confidence. That four scenario setup is very important for us to see that with that profile, empowerment is then the process to changing the shape of this income group of people, features, to enable them to participate effectively in the social economic development. It is a process of obtaining basic opportunities, either directly or indirectly, which include encouraging and
Thank you very much, the moderator, and good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I'd like to thank IDR, the organizer, and also the other co-organizer for having me here to have a chance to talk about things which I think is really, really important. It's important not only for Malaysia, it's important for many, many countries. The moving average, 11 years moving average, this is just to make the graph more reachable. But what this graph tells us is that both Thailand and Malaysia has been enjoying a quite less comfortable growth rate, average growth rate in the past 30, 40 years. So this is not our problem. So this is well known fact. From the richest one to the poorest one. So you are liking the proportion of people in particular quintile, the Q1, Q2, Q5 equal quintile, okay, in 2005, and how and where they end up in 2012. So if there is no social mobility, we would expect that the figure along the diagonal line would be the high one. This is the definition that they choose. I think that is tells you it tells you some story, some useful story of some ethnic groups, people issue. These are well-known disadvantaged group, and this version of the division is that inclusive growth must be the growth process that has an outcome that the disadvantage in the society is itself get reduced. So this is more clearer definition, and that's why I like the idea. So takeaway message, just a summary. The impact, the information that we think or we hope that it will make okay. But as I said earlier, the process of mission might not be the outcome. So we have to monitor it. We have to monitor the outcome. And if the outcome is not what we hope or what we think it would be, then we have to improve. We have to come up with a new measures. So that would be the other part of this circle. So this would be the process interdependent between inclusive code and the eligible thing. And some people have some doubt that, well, maybe people want to live in the city in the first place. They don't want to go back because the life in the city is much better. But this is one example from the survey, from the migration survey. Thailand, it says that this is not the case. Actually, people, if they have choice, they might or they might say that, well, this is a good idea, but can we change a little bit? This proposal get into the government, there will be lobbying, and those kind of things, they can, so at the end, they change the law a little bit, so that they allow the option. For power is the one that will be the process, which measure get implemented. And this idea is applicable to all level of politics, national level, local level, and even politics within the community. So we have to tackle, and there's many ways. As I said, I want to open this as a thought exercise so that you can join me in thinking through. But my last one is called and start democracy there, because I think that is the way to make people know how to how the democracy actually functions. And maybe we can also strengthen the community in the same direction. But we have to do it in a way that do not harm both. So let's stop there. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. I think one important component as far as the speech is concerned is about
the history a bit of our education system and present. Immediately after we secured our independence, Tunku and his cabinet set our national agenda emphasizing two areas. One is to eradicate poverty, and second is to eradicate illiteracy. It was not in any way glamorous to Malaysia at the time compared to Assembly Hall, and given ABC. So my mother, my grandfather, was very angry. We were all very angry at Tunku Abdul Rahman, at Surau, and also Assembly Hall. But when my mother came home, the group that were interested in that kind of stories would be me at the age of 5.
Bukan berdiri, ya.
So I rushed to my mother, open my mother's textbook, and asked her, "What is this? Ini pasal bunga. What is this? Ini kuali. What is this? Ini parang." So Tunku Abdul Rahman inculcated the interest to learn into job market. Again, the cabinet were brave enough in abolishing the requirement of passing secondary 6 examination to go into secondary school. When it was in 1964, secondary school, the most would be secondary school 1, A, B, C, and D, the most would be 4 classes. But in 1965, classes suddenly, the government again will change the examination system from a system where candidates must sit for, they call it SRP system, where or a low certificate application, by attending examination that requires candidate to write essays. But in 1967, that was the first year the outside Malaysia that used Bahasa Melayu as the medium of instruction to the university. Again, criticism from the academic committee, especially, was beyond my imagination. But somehow, government brave enough to introduce it.
First of all, thank you to Mr. Darizwan for inviting me. Start by addressing, because the topic is empowerment of low and middle income. How do we know they have been empowered? What does it mean, good distribution? Does it mean everybody shares the benefit of economic development? Even when you look at Perak, again, I just look at the numbers. Inequality in Perak.
Where do you look in terms of Gini,
have one child policy and the preferred male. Unmarried male with same population as male in France. ASEAN growing at 1%. Malaysia, our household size also shrinking. You have less people, which means you have less people to consume. Less people to consume, you're not going to have. This sounds simple, this sounds logical, but many countries do not do this. In Latin American countries, they spend so much to make sure they count, they know who and where these low-income families are. Indonesia did this when they rationalized their subsidy. They use government offices and they use religious organizations. Even Times Mind to Mind, church time, they go and count low-income people. You can also ensure financial inclusion from home. China, there's a Peking University did a study. Is it more productive to work from home or work from the office? They use the example of call center. People would think, okay, I'm finishing. You would thought that people work, watch TV or sleep, right? But they did not find that. They find call centers operator who work from home is 60% more productive than those working from office. Then this you can do. And access to education also. When we talk about mobility, stop that.
Thank you, growth is a necessity for distribution. I think Malaysia is a very good growth. As far as businesses is concerned, you can see SME growth too, for middle 40.
More of the same syndrome, while promoting self-reliance, so we have to move out. Finally, government in inclusive growth for poverty-focused MFI must be based on key transformation indicators. KPI. For beneficiaries, while fulfilling, to my moderator especially, that after 30 years of applied research, improve the quality of life of the household at the bottom of our income and wealth pyramid, I fail to provide them with sustainable livelihood opportunities, as this is to ensure that Dato' Seri's point tidak yang tertinggal dan tidak terpinggir. So we checked, we went through the database, sometimes the e-kasih have to be changed to p-kasih. Why p? Pilih. People are afraid of getting into debt. Kami takut nak berhutang. Do you have any other way of us assessing your fund? Then I went back and start thinking, where else can I find such opportunity? The answer is in Islamic microfinance product, especially Musharakah and Mudaraba. These are profit sharing schemes that doesn't burden them. And low income, low saving, low investment by providing credit. So, but that is not enough. We realize that we should go for other program which is to create sustainable livelihood. We also prove that so this is my top guru. He was with us here from 1988. And he was very grand. And this is what we are talking about, how the Islamic microfinance will go after those at the bottom of the pyramid. Thank you very much.
We were quite surprised when there is a mention of the effective coverage of the aims to the micro enterprises, because we thought the aims has done a very good job actually. Even their NPL is very low.
I represent young entrepreneurs. I am Perak here. One of the measures of empower the low and middle income is through entrepreneurship. And the recent budget announced by central focus on pushing this entrepreneurship initiative. So my question to the panel's members.
Middle income group touches my heart because my dad said to me he can't give me a home, he can't give me land, but he can give me an education. And Malaysia's actually given me a very good education, which nobody can take it from me. And do you think education is actually one of the most vital things in making sure that you empower your people and you have inclusive growth?
Based untuk yang pelbagai kan industri related to produk yang kita hasilkan supaya tiada migrasi ke bandar. Okay, itu yang pertama lah. Ini pandangan saya yang boleh kita share. Kemudian yang kedua berkaitan dengan BRIM. BRIM baik dari segi pandangan saya, dan dia saya rasa merupakan satu langkah short term sebab dia mempopular program lah. Okay. Lagi satu, saya setuju dengan Doktor Mak Kamil tadi pasal less people to consume. Cuma saya nak minta pandangan panel dan juga siapa yang ada kat sini. Boleh tak kita metropolitankan Malaysia? Sebab kita dah ada metropolitan kat sini, tapi metropolitankan Malaysia sebab populasi kita tidak menjamin kita akan sustain.
Person in the bottom 40 or 50 to empower themselves. Second view, if I got that right, is about this cash handout policy that the Malaysian government has. You know, I have to track carefully here, there are ministers here. But we do give help.
Rosa, wanna jawab the first?
We have a very good panelist here. I would pick some. On the question of the entrepreneurs, this is the first one. I think it's a very good idea about its quality. The quality of education is not equal. If you talk about a country at a middle income level like Malaysia and Thailand, access to education is no longer a problem.
Also, and then organizing dialogues with those households in the process of trying to understand the dynamic, and then at each dialogue, we discuss the issue of how can we scale up this puncak rezeki to become a sustainable livelihood. So in that process, we can generate what we call this entrepreneurship trade. Secondly, in the process of tracking those flows and inflows, we will know the realms of personalities, and entrepreneurship is available in every individual. If we adopt the policy of everyone has his or her own individual worth, then the policy of education should be allowing individual to grow to their fullest, which means the element of entrepreneurship.
Very minimum savings. If you just look at ASB, majority of Malays do not have account in ASB, about 47% have account in ASB, and majority have only about 500 ringgit. How can they afford, and this cut the same for Chinese Indians, how can they afford private universities? They cannot afford unless they take a loan, which means
we can be invited again. This is my second, yang by Dr. Sri. I was a presenter before. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.